So yeah, I mean, I'm going to talk to you about fighting the COVID-19 infodemic. And what we do here is we are taking a holistic approach. So basically, we are looking into the perspective of journalists, fact checkers, social media platforms, policymakers, and the society. And we go beyond what is true and what is false. And so I have added a little bit of some slides because I saw that some other presenters did that. Tell a little bit about our project. So we have here in the Qatar Computing Research Institute, we have a so-called mega project, which kind of is cross-group, includes people from language technologies, from a group, from social computing group, and so on. We have been also developing this for years in cooperation with MIT. So what we do in this project, our goal is to limit the effect of fake news, propaganda, and media bias by making users aware of what they're reading, and the goal is to promote media literacy and critical thinking, which we believe that in the long term is the best way to fight disinformation. So what we have a news aware, a disinformation awareness aggregator, something that you can try it on the both URL. So it's something like Google News, except that it gives you a background information, so it can signal if some news is kind of fishy, or you kind of can get detailed media profiles about a specific news outlet. So, for example, if you're reading something that is skeptical about climate change, you can actually go and you can see whether they have been always skeptical about it, or something that is skeptical about coronavirus and so on. And actually having those profiles, you know, having a list of domains that are good and that are bad is something that I like to say that we can fact check the fake news before it was even written, because we can just check the source where it comes from. Another thing that we do is, again, kind of targeting media literacy, is focusing on the way that people are being manipulated. So instead of looking into whether something is true or false, we are looking into the specific propaganda techniques. So I don't really like the term fake news, because it misleads people to think of kind of false news, and that's not the point. Kind of, you know, the reason why we worry about fake news is because the news got weaponized. I'm happy that at least the European Union level, this is very well understood, and people talk about disinformation, which is something that is both false and means harm. So kind of here, we're looking into the intention to do harm. We're looking into manipulation at the level of appeal to fear, to emotions, to prejudices, logical fallacies, and stuff like that in text. If you have a nice demo on that, you can kind of go and check it. It got the best demo award of Honorable Mention to ACL this year. And we're also building tools that can check, kind of support the work of fact checkers, tools to detect which claims in tweets or in kind of political debates and so on are worth fact-checking, are interesting for fact-checking, so that, you know, journalists can prioritize their work, or to detect whether something has been fact-checked before, kind of, you know, trying to match against the database of previously fact-checked claims. And so what we present has some relation to those two points here. And of course, we are based in Qatar, we kind of care about the region in terms of languages, like Arabic and also English and media and so on. We have APIs, all these things that kind of you see above, they are available to APIs that anybody can use. We have browser plugin, we have Twitter bot, and so on. Now about the COVID-19 infodemic. So yeah, I mean, you guys know that by now, that we are not just fighting a pandemic, we are also fighting the first global infodemic, where you have like a blending of political and medical disinformation. And so the World Health Organization has cited this as, at some point, as number two in the top five priorities in the fight against COVID-19. It was the fighting the infodemic. So now about the hackathon and the task. So what we are doing here, as I said, we have a holistic approach that kind of looks specifically into the problem of COVID-19, is trying to look into the perspective of what journalists would want, what fact checkers would want, what social media platforms might want for content moderation, what policymakers might want, and what society might want. And we have like set up a kind of competition around that. So, I mean, think about it, what kind of tweets you can have about COVID-19. Well, obviously you have jokes and okay. So strictly speaking, those are not, well, I don't know. I mean, it's just a joke, right? So there's nothing interesting about it. There are rumors. Rumors like, oh, there are going to be military helicopters that are going to spray pesticides against the coronavirus. And this is something that we find here, both in Arabic and in English. Yeah, that's a rumor. There are conspiracy theories like, okay, you know, Bill Gates with his vaccines is going to kill us all. These like fake cures, like both garlic water is helping against, you know, the coronavirus. So you see, and then there are other things. This kind of, you know, other way that content can be malicious. So there's a lot of promotion of xenophobia, racism, prejudices, things like don't buy cucumbers from Iran, don't eat Italian food or Chinese food or whatever, especially kind of in the early days of the pandemic. You see this kind of from March 19th. And then there are other things, right? Spreading panic. I mean, oh, the zombie apocalypse is coming and Americans are panic buying weapons and stuff like that, right? So by now you probably see that that's not just about whether it's true or false. It's also kind of, you know, how you can find things that are potentially malicious in other ways. There are other things that you know, might be important for policymakers. I mean, you can have like things like blaming the authorities for their action or inaction. And they might want to pay attention to those things and know, you know, how people are feeling. And then there are also kind of something that we are in our annotation schema that we are paying attention to is positive things. Things again that might inform the general public or the policymakers, because there's a lot of good advice in social media. So for example, here we have this tweet that says, okay, here are recommendations to states about how to reopen and what to do and stuff like that. And there's also discussion of action taken. That's again something that might be important and interesting to policymakers or to journalists and so on in the society as a whole to see what other countries are doing. This kind of an earlier tweet, you know, about, okay, you know, here's what Germany is doing. They started like, you know, 1 million tests per week. By now, that's probably kind of low. Some countries are doing 1 million or more per day, but that's kind of sometime from March, I believe. And there's also call for action. Again, that might be something interesting to consider for policymakers, like close all the barber shops and salons. Discussion of possible cures. That's again something that might attract attention. So for example, he's about chloroquine phosphate. Asking a question, is the virus going to totally disappear in the summer? It's again something that you know, journalists might want to, or fact checkers, they might want to take notice of this and see, okay, many people are asking this question, or maybe policymakers, or maybe the Ministry of Health or something like that. So what we did is we organized the annotation schema around 7 questions, and we have very detailed guidelines that we have refined over several iterations. The first 5 are kind of more related to check worthiness. Kind of the main goal is to answer question number 5. Should a fact checker spend time fact checking this claim? And we have been thinking, what claim is worth fact checking? Well, first of all, it probably has to be viral, has to be kind of popular already. This is how we select the tweets. The second thing is, okay, should have a verifiable factual claim. Okay, so if it's just like something like, it's a nice day today, isn't it? That there's nothing to fact check here. And then it should be likely to contain false information, should be of potential interest to the general public, it should be harmful to the society, to a person, a company, or a product. And all these 4 questions are somehow informing the annotation for question number 5. And then those are mostly yes-no questions or kind of or gradual, like for example, for fact checking, urgent, very urgent, and so on and so forth. No need to check. Here, question 6 and 7, we have more labels. This is kind of more like about why is it harmful to society if it is? And then why should it take the attention of policymakers? We have a detailed annotation schema for that and a nice annotation interface. So basically the way that it goes is, the first thing is we answer with yes or no to the first question. Is there a verifiable factual claim? If there is no verifiable factor true claim, then we skip those five questions. But we do annotate 6 and 7, because even if there is no verifiable factual claim, it can still be harmful. Okay, and so here we have some, you know, you can go on this link and I don't know, I can probably kind of open it now. That's gonna, let me see. Do you guys still see my screen? You don't, because I have shared. Anyway, okay, so I'm back to the presentation. I think I have shared only the presentation, so let me continue with that. I'm going to show you screens after that. And after that, you can, you know, click and annotate for the other questions, and we have here on a button, and you can go and you can read the detailed instructions with examples and so on and so forth. And we have this in English, we have it in Arabic. Here's some distribution of tweets. It's mostly from the US. Some sizable number from India, UK, and some others. So here's the distribution of the data that we have. We have about 500 tweets for English. And you see, those are the labels. Does the tweet contain a verifiable factual claim? We have about, you know, 50-50 split, more or less. And then to what extent it's likely to contain false information, and so on and so forth. Those are kind of the factuality related questions. Those are kind of more the explainability, right? Looking at why it is harmful if it is, or because it spreads panic, or because it's xenophobic, racist, or because it spreads rumors. No, actually it's not harmful, it's just a joke, or stuff like that, and so on and so forth. And we also have Arabic tweets, and we have a similar distribution for that. And we have these things described on our archive. We have quite a lot of detail about this in this article. Here we have kind of another article, which is kind of mostly about the annotation schema that you can have. If somebody wants to help with the actual annotation, we have annotation interface, but of course, this is not the point here of the competition. So what we have in the competition, we have this Codal app that we have set up, and we are offering the task in English and in Arabic, and we are offering it in two levels. So one level is just yes, no. So for example, I don't know, let's say this question, is the tweet harmful to the society and why? Well, one task would be just binary yes. Okay, it's harmful or it's not. So it would be just like yes or no. The other task would be kind of more fine-grained. You'd have to predict not just yes, but you're going to say, yeah, it's harmful because it promotes bad cure, or it's harmful because it spreads panic, or stuff like that, or because it spreads rumors. Okay, and we have a Codal app competition. We have a leaderboard, we have two phases right now. You can submit on the so-called development data, and it's going to go until October 13th. Starting October 14th, actually for 2 days, the last 2 days of the competition, you'll be able to submit on the actual test set, and you're kind of, while you're submitting on the dev set, you're going to see your results and also the leaderboard and see how other people are performing. For the last 2 days, we are going to not to give you back the results. We are just going to record your submission, and you're going to make it visible only after the completion of the competition. And just like to get you some idea, I mean, yes, this can be done. You can actually check into the paper, see, you know, how different models perform on this. Just like to give you some random graph. So here you have the majority class baseline, right? The blue for each of the 7 questions. And I believe this is for the, well, I cannot tell you whether this is for the binary or for the multi-class setup, but doesn't matter. In both cases, we have a similar kind of picture. This is, don't kind of, you know, focus that much on the numbers. Just focus on the fact that it is possible to improve for every single question, both in the binary setup and in the multi-class setup over the majority class baseline. Okay, that's something that we have verified. So it is a task that is doable. It is doable. We actually have like 2 demos that I can, you know, where you can put a tweet and you can make this prediction in the binary case, or kind of yeah, you can explore, you know, some tweets from something. And if we have some preliminary things, just like to make sure that the task that we are proposing is feasible. I'll stop sharing and I'll just kind of maybe open share in a different way. Okay, so here are the things that I started kind of showing you. So this is the detailed annotation instructions that, you know, you can go and you can see how the data was annotated. Yeah, here is the hackathon website, where are the phases and so on and so forth, and where you can submit. We have here links to the annotation instructions, to some of the papers, to the data and so on. And then, okay, what happened here? Yeah, here's kind of demo where I have a random tweet and I can just classify it. Just like to, so for example here, yeah, we have no for the first question, don't make predictions for the rest. And here's kind of the streaming thing where I can go and I can explore the results. I mean, this is just like to you know, something that we want to make sure that it is doable. I think that's it. I'll leave time for questions. Thank you very much. And questions are welcome.
Thank you, Preslav. While you were talking, there are already indication of some questions in the chat. First of all, Gautam, so the previous speaker has the speaker, the questions to you. So
hey, okay. Actually, we are on the same problem. So that's why we have also same questions. So actually, I also look at your paper and the archive before this call also, and I read it also. So I was wondering, so like when you say like volunteer the annotation process and whether the tweet or any message is need to be, and worthiness to be fact checked or something like that. So that the annotator could be any normal person, any in the Arabic language or any English language. How do you like verify the, like whether the person labeled it, like, because the person don't know until it's fact check or something, that don't know that this is a fake news or not. For example, there is a tweet, if you drink ginger hot water, then you might be improve your immune system. There is nothing with like fake news. So how do you ensure the quality of entire annotation process?
So yeah, that's a very good question. Let me kind of go back to sharing, right? So look, actually, if you look into our papers, I mean, we are saying, and actually here in the instructions as well. So you are absolutely right. Okay, first of all these annotations, they are subjective. Okay, so actually some of the things are more objective, some are more subjective. So for example, the first question, whether the tweet contains a verifiable factual claim, that's more or less objective, right? While a question like, to what extent do you think that the tweet appears to contain false information? This is a subjective question. So it's just like we want it to, we kind of just, basically the main question that we have been kind of in the first, okay. So we have, the first question is, does it contain verifiable factual claim? This is an objective question, okay? Here we can say so. The next question, it's a subjective. Do you think that it contains false information or not? I mean, based on kind of, I mean, it's just like, and we feel this somehow kind of mirrors a little bit the how a human fact checker or journalist would approach it. Does it sound fishy? Okay, does it sound suspicious? I mean, it's a subjective thing. I mean, before you have fact checked it, you don't know. I mean, that's why you fact checked it, because you don't know. Is it of interest to the general public? It's a game, you know. If somebody, prime minister says something, maybe it's a general kind of interest. Or if it's something, important, the topic and so on and so forth, maybe it's also kind of. The other thing is, does it sound harmful? Is it attacking somebody, right? So, I mean, this is kind of also the subjective thing, but kind of probably a little bit more objective. And then, do you think that a professional fact checker should check the claim? This is something that we ask you this question only after you have answered the previous ones, because they should somehow, you know, influence your decision. So when we designed those, the first four questions, we have been actually targeting this fifth one, And we have been looking into the literature, we have been talking to fact-checking organizations, trying to understand how do they decide what to fact-check and what not, right? And we have been like, trying to come up with the criteria. For the other questions, you know, is it spreading panic? I think that's kind of more or less objective. Is it a joke? Those are kind of more objective things, right? Does it spread bad cure? You know, spreads rumors or conspiracy? Okay, maybe if you are not aware of the conspiracy, maybe you believe it. Okay, so it's kind of partially subjective, but those are kind of, you know, a little bit safer, and so on and so forth. I mean, and we had every single question was annotated by between 3 and 5 annotators, and then was discussed basically by up to 10 annotators. And it had been, the discussion time was taking quite sometimes 2-3 times longer than the original annotation, and led to revision of the instructions. But we do have reasonable agreement, right? We have numbers and so on. But yeah, they subject to it. Yeah.
Okay. So thank you for explaining all this thing, all details. So like based on the first round of data, like I think this platform is running from more than last 3 or 4 weeks. So what is the agreement which you have got for different questions? So like any idea on, I mean, any emphasis on that?
Agreement. Okay, so I can share with your numbers, right? I'll share with your numbers right now. Just a second. I need to share in a different way because, just a second. Oops. Okay, I found it. Agreement. Okay. So let me share in a different way. I think it's this. Okay. You guys see here? Okay. So here's the agreement, right? So C is the consolidated agreement. So after we have done everything, right? We took 50 fresh goods, right? After, you know, kind of, we have now the annotators trained, we have the guidelines finalized. So we took like 50 fresh goods and we computed the agreement between the final consolidation and agreement annotator 1, 2, 3, and so kind of here you see the inter-annotator agreement. Basically, yeah, it's five kappa in the multi-class way and in the binary case, where kind of you only care whether you get yes and no correctly, as opposed to the reason why. It makes a difference with other questions. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for explaining.
Sure.
Okay, thank you very much. And there is another question from Said, and I think maybe it's more than one question. So Said, do you want to say it yourself?
Hi, thank you. I think my question was also related to the one asked by Gautam. I mean, the annotation process done by volunteers, and you explained that already very well. But the size of the data set, like 500, it will be very few to build a model based on this data set. I mean, what will be the purpose of, how do you expect us to participate in this hackathon? Is that just like to have some kind of insight based on this 500 data set or to build a model and so on? I guess 500 is to the lower side.
So, those are good points. And there are like different answers here. One is, we know it's doable because we did it, right? And we have the same data set. I have even shown you some demos, right? I mean, and we have some numbers. We know that it's possible to improve over the data set, right? So that's one thing. Another thing is, we would very much like to expand this a lot. It's not easy. So, we have been doing this annotation ourselves, and I don't know, maybe to annotate a 50 examples take probably like 2 days or something to several people. So that's kind of quite some effort because we really, really care about quality here, and we are discussing every single example, even when we agree. And in some rare cases, we might kind of, you know, change some label. We even kind of did post-analysis, automatic analysis, trying to see, so here's an example, here's another example that somehow superficially, I don't know, using some kind of semantic similarity, this tweet looks similar to this one. And why is it that here we have this label and here we have this other label? So kind of we change like the labels of two or three examples, you know, based on you know, kind of this kind of analysis. So really, really kind of cared about quality. We don't think we can crowdsource this. You cannot put it in a mechanical crowd flower or whatever, because, I mean, you're not going to get the quality that you want. So we have been doing this in-house, and, you know, it took quite some time to train. Another thing about the size, I can say is that, unfortunately, this is the situation with most of the data sets. I think that some of the data sets from the speakers before, they also had something around, if I'm not mistaken, of about 500, 600 examples.